Thank you for this introduction. Which language I'm supposed to speak? Because English? Okay. Well, then I'm sorry because I brought sort of slides in Russian because I've just made this is a presentation at the Mining Institute where they preferred Russian. Anyway, basically, I don't think I'll be covering much of the BP strategy in Russia in my main presentation. But of course, if we have time and you have such questions, I'll be glad to tell you what I can tell you about this. But I'll start with sharing with you our company's view on developments of global energy markets. Is it now? No, I don't see. You see the difference? Okay, fine. BP is probably one of leading energy companies that thinks that it does make sense to keep a pretty large, I mean, by energy company standard group of economists, and we produce two main public products every year. In June, we launch BP Statistical Review of World Energy, which, if you're involved in energy studies, you've probably seen, and it's not modest, but I have to say that it's one of the most widely used of source of data on energy markets. And in the beginning of each year, we produce an updated forecast of the global energy markets to 2030. And what I'll be talking about today is this letter paper and presentation, which basically summarizes our views on what has already changed in the energy markets, what is most interesting to watch at the moment there, and also what we expect to happen over the next almost two decades. I'll sort of take you through slides which are divided into four main sections. First, general trends, then I'll cover liquids, so basically oil and other liquid fuels, then gas, coal, and other non-fossil, basically renewable energy sources. So starting with general trends, there are two main factors that drive energy demand. One is population growth, another one is economic growth. And on this slide, I hope that you can see it, and colors are the same. Yeah. You see our assumptions on the population growth and GDP, global GDP growth, to 2030. In a nutshell, we share the United Nations view that by 2030, the population of the world will be around 8.3 billion people, which is 1.3 billion more than live today. And according to our forecast, the global economy will double by 2030 relative to our base year, which is 2011. But if you look at the sort of at the tab on the right of this slide, you may see that growth in energy consumption will not be as significant as population growth or economic growth, and I'll be explaining why we think that energy consumption in the world, consumption of primary energy resources, will grow only by 36% between 2011 and 2030. Although, if one sort of follows the trend for previous years, this growth should have been much more significant. You may have noticed on a previous slide that we divide the world in two basic groups. OECD, which is a club of most developed nations, and non-OECD, which comprises the rest of the world. I mean, not a very scientific grouping, but still we find it pretty useful, at least at the moment. Basically, what this division shows is that most of growth in energy demand will come from catching up economies, from those that do not yet have per capita income comparable with these 20 plus countries, which at the moment are members of the OECD. OECD is an Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development, which is this club of the most rich nations in the world. If you look at the tab in the middle, you'll see that sector-wise, production of power or electricity will be the main sector, which will be responsible for an increase in demand for primary energy resources. In our forecast, demand in the power gen will grow by 49% over the forecast period. And the second most significant sector is industry, where demand will grow by 31%. And basically, if we look at an increment between the base year and 2030, 57% of incremental growth in energy demand will come from the power sector. So electricity is the main business for which the world needs energy resources. And at the last tab, on the right-hand side, you may see the sort of the division of this energy increment by specific resources. Actually, it might not be very visible on this slide, but renewables, which are on the top, will grow faster than any other source of primary energy. In our forecast, renewables will grow on average by 7.4% over this period, which is a lot. But as you may see, the share of renewables in the total energy mix in the world will not be very significant by 2030. It's not that we don't like renewables or think that it doesn't make sense to develop them. They're just a matter of fact. I mean, they grow from such a low base that even by 2030 they will be able to contribute only around 6-7% to the total energy consumption in the world. Perhaps noteworthy is that the second fastest growing fuel in the world will be nuclear. And this might sound counterintuitive after what happened in Fukushima in Japan, but still that's what we see in the energy demand growth. We just see that countries like China, India, and even Russia will not be able to satisfy growth in their energy demand without developing pretty major nuclear capacity. And of course, gas, as you may see, remains a pretty important part of the energy mix, even by 2030, although I'll be talking a little bit later about sort of deceleration in growth of coal. And one fossil fuel which keeps growing pretty steadily is gas. Actually, among fossil fuels, gas will be the fastest growing part. We think that gas consumption, and hence production, will be growing on average by 2% a year. Coal will, over this decade, keep growing faster than gas, so over 2% per annum. But we, as I said, expect a pretty dramatic deceleration of growth in coal consumption after 2020. So on average, for the whole for the period as a whole, we expect coal growing by just 1.2%. So almost half the pace for gas. And oil will be the slowest growing fuel, with the average growth of just 0.8% a year. Most of my presentation will be focusing around recent developments which many observers call shale revolution. Originally, people were talking about shale gas, but over the recent years, shale oil, or more precisely, tight oil, and there is a geological difference, but basically you may call it shale just for the convenience of it. That's something which changes all forecasts, including ours, very fast. If you look at this slide, which shows comparison of our recent, latest forecast with the previous year's forecast, you may see that production of oil and gas in North America is a factor which changed most. And why? Just because production of shale gas and shale oil grows so fast that everybody, including BP, has to adjust our expectations with the same speed. So, as I said, power generation will lead the incremental energy demand, and you may see the breakdown of this growth by sector and by the region of the world. And on the left-hand side, you may see that, of course, China and India will be dominant powers in terms of incremental energy use in all sectors, in power generation or in industry or in transportation. On the other hand, we may see on the right-hand side that the fuel mix and power generation would be the most diverse one. You see that basically all energy resources, all primary energy resources will contribute to growth in power generation. If we turn to production, because so far I've talked about consumption, we may see that the catching up world, non-OECD countries will contribute most of growth as well. So 78% of an increment in production of primary energy will also come from non-OECD countries. And on the right-hand side, you may see is a regional breakdown of this growth. An interesting observation which we ended up in our forecast is that by 2030, the global energy mix will become much more evenly distributed relative to either today or the past. Because the world has always lived through eras of something, of some energy. Originally it was timber, or now it would be called biomass. Then it was coal, then it was oil. Now we are entering what the International Energy Agency calls an era of gas, golden era of gas. But if we look at our numbers, we'll just see that, yeah, it is true that oil will be losing its position in the global energy mix. Coal, which has been growing pretty fast over recent years, will slow down. Gas will continue growing, and so by 2030, each of these hydrocarbons will contribute from 26 to 28% of total primary energy used in the world. And you may see similar convergence among non-fossil fuels, hydro energy, nuclear energy, and renewables. But all of them will contribute much less relative to fossil fuels to global energy production. So basically, even by 2030, oil, coal, and gas will contribute over two-thirds of energy which the world needs. And if we turn to the right hand, we'll see sort of one of explanations why the shares, change. And the first thing which is visible there is that oil prices have grown most among energy resources, and of course this is one of the main drivers for a decline in share of oil in global energy consumption. People try to use energy resources to substitute other energy resources for oil, which happens to be most expensive. And actually, this has interesting implications, which I'll be talking about a little bit later, because basically oil has become a very specialized fuel. It is used only predominantly in transportation. In all other sectors, and I'll show this, it has been squeezed out. Another thing which we need to keep in mind when we talk about energy demand in the world is that energy efficiency will keep growing. You may see on the left-hand side that basically energy intensity, economic energy intensity, which is amount of energy used to produce $1 of GDP in all countries in the world and in the world as a whole, reaches the peak at some moment in time and then declines. And this is, as you may see, that has been true for the United States, it has been true for the European Union, and it will also be true for China, which alongside Russia happens to be one of the least energy efficient nations in the world at the moment. But basically, why this matters is shown on the right-hand side, where you see sort of a growing gap between dynamics of GDP, so economic growth, and growth in energy consumption. So that's exactly this energy growth and energy efficiency which I am talking about. And that's basically one of the most important things about this forecast, because perhaps you're aware that many people still are worried that the world will just not have enough commodities and energy commodities in the first place to satisfy growing need. What we are saying is that higher energy efficiency will make the situation tolerable, and in our forecast, energy demand grows by 36% by 2030, as I said. And if there had been no growth in energy efficiency, the world would have consumed twice as much energy as it consumes today. So instead of 100% increment, we are talking about 36%, just because energy use is becoming more and more efficient. This is a sort of a summary slide of general trends, which shows you the development of the global energy balance between 2011 and 2030. I guess on the left, on the demand side, there is nothing specifically interesting. It just shows that most of demand will come from developing nations, catching up nations. But on the right-hand side, you may see something more interesting. I've talked about renewables, that they will be growing, but still not be the major force in energy production. What is interesting is to look at oil and gas. If you see, both of these columns are divided into two sections. One is called shale, and the other is other, which stands for conventional, traditional oil and gas fields. And basically, it's visible. If it's not visible, trust me, contribution of this shale resources, shale gas and shale oil, will be 20%. 20% of global energy increment over the forecast period will come from shale gas and shale oil. Why it matters? It matters because only 5 years ago, nobody would expect this to happen. That's something which is developing right in front of our eyes, and that's a process which changes not only forecasts, it changes the way energy markets work, and I'll be speaking about this in more detail in a second. So let me switch to liquid fuels, and on this slide you may see the declining share of oil, as I said, in total energy, and more interesting, on the right hand side you may see that oil use in all sectors but transport declines very significantly. We expect that oil will be almost completely squeezed out of power generation by 2030. And again, as I mentioned, explanation is pretty simple. I mean, if you can use something cheaper than oil, you have all the incentives to do that. And that's why in industry and in the commercial sector, the usage of oil will also keep falling. Even in transport, which remains the sort of main bastion for oil, we expect the share of oil declining, not as significant than power generation, but still. At the moment, oil contributes almost 100% of energy used in transportation. By 2030, we think that oil will contribute 88%, and the balance will be contributed by natural gas, 5%, by biofuel, 5%, and by electricity, electric cars, but just only about 1 to 2%. And again, we may discuss, and if you're interested, you may ask why we think that, for instance, natural gas will contribute more to fuel use in transport than electricity. Although at the moment, people talk about electrical cars much more than about gas-driven cars. But we think that sort of the markets will work otherwise. Another thing which we need to bear in mind speaking about transport is that, I mean, this general trend of high efficiency is also quite visible in transportation. On the right-hand side of the slide, you may see that in all regions of the world, all main consuming nations, efficiency of cars will grow. And so basically, amount, volume of oil you need to drive 100 kilometers will keep declining. And actually, again, it will be convergent, which is explained by growing globalization of the world, and basically new cars becoming available across the globe quite fast. If we look at the production, this slide shows that we think that in terms of liquid fuels, the Americas, both North and South America, will become almost as significant as producers of liquids as the Middle East, the current biggest producers. Actually, you may see that we expect that in the middle of the current decade, the Americas will be producing more liquid fuels, including biofuel, than the Middle East. And again, that's a pretty big change. And I'll be showing you sort of more specifics about this a little bit later. This slide is basically one of the first which illustrates these revolutions, which I've already mentioned. On the right-hand side, you may see our expectations for growth of tight oil. And basically, again, I don't know whether it makes sense to mention what tight oil and shale gas is. I usually think that people who sort of focus on energy or geology know that, but I've just presented a lecture at the Mining Institute, and after the lecture I got a question what shale was about. So if it may be useful, I can just explain the difference between conventional oil and gas and shale oil, shale gas and tight oil. Will that make sense, or everybody knows, so I may save time?
Our American students should know. I don't know about the rest.
Okay, but just in a few words, I mean, just to sort of in simple words, the difference between, I mean, the product is the same. It's either oil or gas. It's for gas, it's still methane. So there is no difference in the product. And for oil, it's basically the same combination of hydrocarbon fractions. The difference is only in the nature of the geological resource. So conventional field is sort of is something which has pretty high permeability. So basically, by drilling one well and stimulating sort of oil or gas flow underground by special wells, you may extract either oil or gas, because gas and oil can be moved within the field. But shale gas and tight oil are basically concentrated on small bubbles within the rock. And so if you just drill one well, you hit several bubbles and you won't get much. So you need to apply different technologies basically to crack this rock and make gas and oil flow into the well through which you'll be extracting them. And that's something which is not rocket science. Basically, it takes only two technologies which have been sort of known for decades. The first one is horizontal or directional drilling, and the second one is hydrofracturing. Although technology is developing so fast that by now there are, for instance, instances where it's called dry hydrofracturing, which is an oxymoron because, I mean, basically there is, I mean, no water involved. But in any case, I mean, you just need to crack the rock to extract this shale gas or tight oil. And as I've said, although both the resource base has been known for many years, and these technologies have been known for many years, it took some sort of some initiative, sort of market initiative, in the US for people to realize that by combining these technologies, they can unlock this resource which had not been used before. In any case, so coming back to nowadays, on the right-hand side, you see our expectations of growth in the North America, and you may see that, and that's an important risk to our forecast, and again, I'll be explaining why later. We expect pretty fast growth of tight oil production in the US over the current decade, and then we expect deceleration of this growth in the second decade, and that's a very important assumption. If this doesn't happen, if oil production, tight oil production in the US will keeps growing, after 2030, the world will be completely different. And to show you why, I would draw your attention to one line on the left-hand side, which is this dotted line representing the share of OPEC in global liquids production. And as you may see, we expect a pretty dramatic decline in OPEC production over the current decade. But later, I mean, in the decade after 2020, we expect production in OPEC to start growing again. Why we think that OPEC will have lower production before 2020? It's not because OPEC is running out of the resource base. Oil is there. But to support prices, OPEC as a cartel will have to do something about growing production in countries which are not members of OPEC. And if we come back to the right-hand side, we see this significant growth of non-conventional tight oil, and we think that by 2030, non-conventional resources will contribute 9%, about 9% of global liquids production. But anyway, coming back to this decade, to offset this rapid growth in North America, OPEC will have to cut production. Otherwise, prices will just fall and fall very significantly. Actually, in economic terms, and I hope that you or at least the right economist in this room, who would understand how the demand curve looks and what sort of low elasticity of demand means. Basically, we live at the moment at the sort of very top part of the demand curve, where elasticity of demand is very low. In simple terms, it's very easy to explain. I mean, because of high prices, oil has been squeezed out of all sectors where people were able to substitute some other energy resource for oil. So oil has become very specialized, which means two things. First, it means that if price goes up very much, demand does not decline very much, just because there is nothing. I mean, oil is used in areas where there is no other resource that can be used to substitute for oil. But the sort of the reverse side is that if there is any small redundancy on the market, so if the market has to absorb more oil than is used in these specialized sectors, then price has to go down very significantly for the market to absorb this small increment. And that's exactly what happens whenever either the demand declines or demand declines, or if there is more oil on the market than is needed. And again, in simple terms, it is pretty easy, I think, to understand that just those people who at the moment do not use oil will start using it only if price of oil goes down very significantly. But in any case, given that the budgets in many OPEC countries at the moment balance only at the price level of $90 per barrel, we think that it will be very rational for OPEC to cut production to support prices. Because as I said, if they don't, if they continue producing at the current levels while growth of tight oil continues outside of OPEC, basically the pressure on prices will be very high. So we expect that OPEC will cut production. But as I said, after 2020, the situation will become sort of easier for them. So the call on OPEC will again start growing. But as I said, and as the right-hand side of this slide shows, that is based on an assumption that growth in tight oil production will decelerate. If there is no such deceleration, OPEC's life will be difficult for not just for several years, but a pretty long period of time. And as you may realize, that brings a lot of risks to the way OPEC works. So basically, we think that the current and next decade will be a pretty interesting time for the oil market and for the oil price, which is particularly important in Russia, in this country, just because economy of this country depends on the price of oil very much. Again, these are trivial facts, but let me just repeat it, that contribution of oil and gas sector to GDP of Russia is over 20%, that oil and gas sector taxes contribute over 50% of the federal budget income revenues, and oil and gas alone contribute 66% to Russia's exports, which is basically one of the main driving forces and channels by which money come into the economy. Anyway, so the slide on the screen shows that we expect that 100% of net growth in liquids production over the current decade will come from unconventional sources: tight oil, oil sands, and biofuel. And in the next decade, after 2020, again, their contribution will be still important, but only around 75%. And if we turn to the right-hand side, for OPEC, it will mean that this red line, that over the next decade, they will be able to increase production. But before that, even if this is the case, they will have to live through a difficult time. And this gray shadow shows you why. this line shows you the level of spare capacity in OPEC. Spare capacity is sort of the main instrument for OPEC to control production and hence prices. So basically, if you cut production, you immediately get more spare capacity, so which stands idle. And as you may see on this slide, we think that by sort of 2018, spare capacity in OPEC will have to go up to 6 million barrels per day, which will be the highest level since the 80s. And in terms of maintaining discipline within OPEC, will be a risk factor in itself. Why? That's because at the moment, most of spare capacity, and hence ability to produce more, is concentrated in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia and some other Gulf nations. But if we look at the history of OPEC and look who sort of who misbehaved, who didn't want to maintain quota discipline, and you know that OPEC works by way of quota, so each nation comprising OPEC has its own production quota. So in the past, there were incidents where this discipline was ruined. So basically, countries started to produce more than they were allowed according to their quota. So why I think that this high capacity will be a risk factor is that to maintain this high level, not only Saudi Arabia, but also sort of regular suspects, countries like Nigeria or Venezuela, will get spare capacity. And that's all with time Iran. So that were exactly countries that that were producing over their quota in the past. At the moment, they cannot do that. They basically produce at their maximum capacity. Again, we can discuss how they damaged their oil sectors, Nigeria, Venezuela, Iran, that they don't have any spare capacity. But again, that's just the fact. So at the moment, they don't have the spare capacity, and so they are unable to misbehave, but they might get spare capacity in the future. And another factor, even if we forget about tight oil, there is another factor which OPEC will have to tackle, which is called Iraq. You may see at the top of the most right-hand column that production in Iraq will be growing. And why it is different from OPEC. Iraq is a member of OPEC, but Iraq is a special member of OPEC. It's the only nation in the cartel which doesn't have a quota. It hasn't been having quota since the first Gulf War. So basically, the government of OPEC has signed contracts with oil companies, which in total would give production of 12 million barrels per day. I mean, for those who are unaware, this is more than either Saudi Arabia or Russia produce at the moment. And at the moment, Saudi Arabia and Russia are the biggest oil producers in the world. Not many people believe that Iraq will be able to increase its production to 12 million barrels per day, but still something in the order of 6.5 million barrels per day, which is a pretty significant growth relative to the current 2.5-3 million barrels per day. I mean, that's something which OPEC will have to somehow incorporate into their decision making. Either they will have to agree that Iraq will agree to become a part of the quotation system, but again, so far the government of Iraq has been making it quite clear that they don't want to do that, or Saudi Arabia and other leading producers in OPEC will have to cut their production even more to offset not just growth in tight oil, but also a growth of oil production in Iraq. Okay, let me switch to natural gas. The situation there is pretty similar to what I've been talking about with respect to oil. Again, shale gas revolution changes the situation dramatically. I mean, for those of you who are Americans, you may say it firsthand, but I mean, in simple, in this sort of simple words, everybody in the energy industry expected the U.S. to become a major importer of natural gas. I mean, only just 7-10 years ago. And as you perhaps know, a lot of facilities were built on the coast of the United States to import LNG, liquefied natural gas. So these regasification facilities are now exactly, I mean, they stand idle because the U.S. does not need to import LNG. And moreover, by now companies are planning to sort of to change this facility from regasification to liquefaction once to export gas from the United States. And that's exactly the result of the shale gas revolution. And we think, unlike some people in the leading gas producer in this country, Gazprom, we think that the shale gas revolution and shale gas growth will continue. So by 2030, we think that shale gas will be contributing around 17% to total gas production in the world. But again, you may see this deceleration after 2020. I mean, all these decelerations are based on the current understanding of the geological profile of tight oil and shale gas fields in the US. And my concern about these profiles are that, in my experience, they keep changing. I mean, that's basically, if you go to an aggregate oil production in the world, that's exactly an argument proponents of the peak oil theory use. They say that the world will run out of oil resources. But what we see is that actually it just doesn't happen and it's not going to happen in the foreseeable future, just because basically the world is able to find new resources and produce more and more. And so this profile changes. And that's, as I said, that's a risk for tight oil, that's a risk for OPEC, and indirectly for Russia, because it will be a pretty important thing for the oil price. And this sort of deceleration in gas production will also be important to Russia, just because Russia is a major gas exporter. And one interesting thing to mention about competition between the US gas, American gas, and Russian gas, is that the American gas already competes with Russian gas, although the United States do not export any gas produced on its territory. Why? Again, for Americans it will be easy to understand, but let me sort of take you through the logic of it. The shale gas revolution resulted in pretty low gas prices in the United States. As a result, consumers have started to switch to gas from other energy resources. And most importantly, in power generation, more and more gas has been burnt. And gas started to squeeze out coal from power generation in the United States. So this coal has become redundant and basically has been exported. And it was shipped over to Europe. And the price situation in Europe has become a complete opposite to what happened in the US. In the US, it was and is more efficient to produce electricity burning gas. I mean, more efficient and more profitable than produce electricity by burning coal. In Europe, as I said, it's the opposite. In Europe, because of this inflow of coal, coal prices went down so much that for the last 2 years, anybody who is trying to produce electricity by burning gas runs losses. Because basically coal, and because of this, coal has been substituted for gas in Europe. And this drives gas demand in Europe down. And this matters for Russia, because Europe does not need as much gas as everybody hoped, including Russian exporter. That's the way how sort of American gas competes with the Russian one. Over the last 4 years, gas production in Russia have been below production in the United States. And again, not because Russia has run out of gas resources, gas is there, but demand for this gas in Europe, which is the major Russian market to which Russia exports from 100 to 150 BCMA, I mean, is lower than everybody hoped for. So Russia again, has to cut its own production just because gas is not needed. And Russia is stubborn enough not to agree to lower prices. But anyway, so the situation in Europe, which is the main export market for Russian gas, is, as I said, has changed exactly because of shale revolution in the United States. And that's perhaps why many people from the gas industry in this country do not like, basically they hate shale revolution, and also say that it's a bubble. It's a soap bubble which will burst very soon. I would not subscribe to this view, but in any case, that's what is happening. And this slide shows you our expectations for growth in shale gas production in the US, in European Union, where you may see that we are pretty conservative. Again, to save time, I won't be talking why. If you're interested, I can explain. But in any case, as I've just said, it doesn't matter that Europe will not be producing a lot of shale gas. It suffices for the United States to produce a lot of shale gas and exporting this gas for the situation with Russian gas to be completely different from Gazprom expectations. And again, in China, we think that shale gas production will start, and by 2030, China will be producing around 60 billion cubic meters of shale gas, which will be around 20% of their indigenous production. And another major change on gas markets is development of LNG. LNG basically is the force, LNG, liquefied natural gas, is the force which contributes to globalization of gas markets. Because so far the world has three major markets, North American one, European, and the one in Asia. And they are still sort of regional markets. There is no global market which is most visible in the difference, in the price difference between these markets. So at the moment, the price of gas in the United States is the lowest. In Europe, it's in the middle, and the highest price is in Southeast Asia, and basically in Asia Pacific. And so LNG has already started to change that, just because LNG makes it possible to move gas from one region to another. I mean, the reason why the gas market has been segmented so far is that pipeline has always been the main mean of transporting gas. And building a pipeline from North America to Europe is a pretty hopeless exercise if one cares about economics. But LNG makes shipment of gas from one corner of the world to a completely different corner of the world quite possible and also profitable. So what will matter for gas markets is that you see this flattening of LNG growth over the next 2 to 3 years, but after 2017, we expect another wave of LNG hitting the market. So basically, we think that by 2030, LNG will double again relative to our base year. So the gas market will become much more competitive and much more integrated because of this growth in LNG. And on the right-hand side, you may see, again, another indicator of sort of higher diversification of LNG markets. So basically, each exporter has been exporting gas to more and more consumers, and each consumer has been importing gas from more and more suppliers. Again, that's what makes gas market resembling the oil one. So basically, it will be an integrated where both exporters and importers will have free choice of a destination from which to import or to which to import to export, and that's a pretty significant change because, as I said, I mean, at the moment we don't have such markets. So this is a summary slide for gas, and you may see that shale gas will be an important contributor to gas growth on our count, that will contribute around 37% of an increment in gas production. But still, you may see that conventional gas will still contribute. It's easy to calculate if 37 comes from the shale gas, so 63% will come from conventional gas, and that's exactly where we see hope for Russia, because we think that there are good chances that Russian gas will be competitive. It will take a complete sort of change in Russia's gas policy, but we think that the pressure will make Russia making these changes, and we think that Russia will be able to grow its export capacity by another 170 billion cubic meters by 2030. So, but again, I mean, that's our hope and that's our forecast. If Russia doesn't change its policy, and first of all, pricing policy, we might not see this growth in Russia's exports. Quickly, taking you through coal and the rest, as you may see, the coal story is basically China and India. By 2030, we think that these two nations will account for 64% of global coal consumption. So basically, as you may see, they will consume more coal than any than the rest of the world, and of course, power generation in China in particular will be the main consumer of gas. Renewables, as I mentioned, they will be growing very fast, but from a very small base, so we don't see them becoming the major source of primary energy. And another thing which we need to bear in mind is that renewables are still not competitive. Development of either solar or wind in most places requires subsidies. I mean, this production would never happen if not for government subsidies in the developed nations. And with time, this becomes a problem for these countries, and we already see it in a country like Germany, where basically they've become a victim of their own success. The government of Germany likes renewables very much, so they subsidize production of renewables, particularly of solar. But again, with production of solar energy growing, the amount of subsidies, total amount of subsidies the budget has to cough up, also keeps growing. And in Germany, it is already a problem. In some countries, like Spain, for instance, in the time of the financial crisis, that just became unbearable. So Spain has had to cut subsidies to solar and wind, and guess what? Both solar and wind stopped growing in Spain immediately, just because without subsidies, I mean, that's not a profitable business, and nobody wants to lose money in the market, as you may understand. Let me skip this slide. Last thing which I should have mentioned about renewables and the situation in Europe is that there was another victim of this growth in renewable production in Europe. And that was the European trading scheme developed for carbon trading. So in Europe, it's mandatory to buy sort of a carbon credit. So if you're going to emit CO2, you have to buy a credit to be allowed to do so. And of course, given that burning coal produces twice as much CO2 as burning gas, coal should have been disadvantaged to gas with this system in existence. But basically, because of significant growth in renewables, it turned out that the European Commission has grossly miscalculated the amount of CO2 emission. So basically, they designed a system where they said, okay, you would be allowed to emit as much. CO2, tons of CO2, and here allocations of these emissions to you, and you may trade them. But what happened is that in practice, European industry and power generation have emitted much less CO2 than they were allowed, just because renewables do not emit CO2 at all. Much less than either coal-fired or gas-fired power generation, and this basically took the whole trading system to a collapse. And prices for carbon in Europe, which used to be around $20 per ton, are now around 3 to 6. And that's again, I've told you that. Gas has become disadvantaged to coal because of low coal price in Europe, but it has also become disadvantaged just because this carbon trading system collapsed. So again, I mean, this miscalculation on the part of the European Commission has led to gas being squeezed out from power generation, and I mean, this region of the world, which is allegedly is caring more about climate change and sort of reduction in carbon emission, happened to be burning more and more coal. So in the United States, power generation facilities burn less and less coal. In Europe, it's quite the opposite. Anyway, so let me show you several last slides. That's not an important one, but still I think an interesting one, which compares the resource endowment in various parts of the world and actual production, forecasted production. These regions of the world, which are, I hope, it's sort of grayish, bluish color, these are exporters, net exporters of energy. And this greenish, light greenish one, are importers. And if you compare the resource endowment and production we expect to be there by 2030, you may see that important nations, and it's pretty intuitive, they are using their resource base much more intensive relative to exporting nations. So the total share of energy importers in the sort of global resource base is only 16%. We expect that by 2030 they will contribute over 1/3 of global energy production, so oil and gas production. So basically, they will be using their oil and gas base much more intense. And that's even more visible on this slide, where we compare sort of current level of resources, tight oil resources and shale gas resources in various regions in the world with expected production. And you may see that although the Asia Pacific has more tight oil and shale gas resources than North America, we still think that production in the Asia Pacific will be much lower than in North America by 2030. And again, we may discuss the differences which make us think so, but again, that's what we expect. I may skip the slide, but I still think that the right-hand side is pretty illustrative whenever one thinks about tight oil. It basically shows you number of wells drilled last year, over recent years, and in particular last year, on just one field in the United States, Bakken. You may see that on just one field, more wells were drilled last year than in the whole country of Canada. But that allowed to grow production on Bakken by a factor of 10, from 5 to 50 million tons over the last 5 years, and actually one field produces as much oil as the whole country of Colombia. But again, what is most important about this is that tight oil requires a lot of drilling, and that's why country has to be has to have a pretty developed oil service sector to afford to produce tight oil. And this slide, and I guess I'll just stop there, show a comparison of our forecast for tight oil and shale gas production with other available in the expert community. And as you may see, we're pretty conservative of on tight oil, and we the middle by 2030 as far as shale gas is concerned. In other words, there is pretty significant upside in both tight oil and shale gas production. So if those people who are more optimistic than us happen to be true, the situation for OPEC will be even more dire than I've described, just because there will be even more oil production growth that they will have to offset. And the situation for Russia will become even more vulnerable, just because there will be more gas on the market. And we see new supplies in East Africa, in East Mediterranean, coming to the market over the nearest future. And that makes the gas market not only more integrated, but also and diversified, but also much more competitive. So a simple conclusion of all this is that we're likely to live through decades of a much more competitive oil and gas markets. And that will be a pretty significant change to the past. And again, last thing which I would mention, and perhaps again, those who are from America already know that, basically the major change in the world will be that by 2030, the United States will become almost energy independent. And many people only start to think what this will mean for geopolitics. And I've spoken to some American politicians who have just started to realize that, again, the whole sort of fundamentals of geopolitics are going to change. I mean, by saying that the United States will become energy self-sufficient in net terms, we don't mean that the United States will stop importing oil, but it will be importing not 50-60% of oil, but just 20%. And exports of coal and exports of gas will allow the United States to be basically almost a net energy exporter by 2030. And that's a pretty significant change. Okay, I guess I already spoken enough. And if you have questions, because although I've spoken enough, there are much more areas which could have been covered. So if you have questions, I'll try to answer them. You know, you have to distinguish between companies' status as an operator, and all these four regions that Bob has mentioned are sort of countries where BP is an operator, and countries where we are a shareholder. In Russia, we used to be a shareholder of TNK-BP. We are now a minority shareholder of Rosneft, but we are not an operator in this country. So BP, as a company, has not been producing any oil or gas in Russia, unlike Azerbaijan, where we are an operator, Angola, or the Gulf. And basically, that's what we are likely to have in the sort of years to come. So again, I will have to mention a lot of peculiarities of the Russian regulatory system to explain why we are not an operator in this country. But if you are aware of all these regulations, again, we do not expect to become a major operator of either gas or oil fields in Russia. So, I mean, that's what he meant. It doesn't mean that Russia is not a priority country for us. I mean, it's just not a priority for producing oil or gas on our own. And again, you mentioned that gas production in Azerbaijan is declining. Actually, we expect to produce, Shah Deniz 2 is a major project for BP, and perhaps you know that it will be the first and the most significant, at least for initial years, the resource base for the Southern Corridor. I mean, this set of new pipelines which will bring gas from the Caspian to Europe. So again, we do expect gas production there to grow. We are keenly aware of our problems in the Gulf, but again, with time, we think that we'll be able to proceed with some of our major projects there of deep water drilling, where actually we still hope that we'll be successful.
Sure. You mentioned the Shah Deniz 2 being maybe built for access to the Southern Corridor. Can you elaborate a little bit more on how that gas will get from Shah Deniz 2 to Europe?
No. Just because, that's commercially sensitive, because come June we will have to make a decision on an exact route, because at the moment there are several sort of options we can pursue. I mean, there's Trans-Adriatic, Western Nabucco, and basically, again, I can't prejudge the decision which we'll make in June. Well, I would say that the regulatory regime in Russia is the reason why foreign investment in Russian oil and gas is much lower relative to what it could have been. I mean, just to give you one figure, 20% of investment in development of shale gas and tight oil in the US came from foreign companies. So in Russia, it's not so. Just because there is a law on strategic industries which sort of limit participation of foreign companies in oil and gas, which are considered to be strategic industries. There is a subsoil law which brings more complications, and there are various other sort of limits. As you know, on Arctic shelf, only public companies are allowed to operate, so a foreign company like, for instance, ExxonMobil has already done, have to become a sort of minority stakeholder in a joint venture. So again, there are difficulties in Russia, there are difficulties in China. Regulatory difficulties. For instance, China is pretty keen on allowing foreign companies to help them developing shale gas. But for doing so, they even had to change the whole classification and design a special category for shale gas. Because if you look at the Chinese legislation, it's pretty similar to Russian, and even worse. Because there, participation of foreign companies in production of oil and gas is just banned. So, but they've introduced this shale gas category, which would allow them to consider this a new resource and take it from under the auspices of this sort of drastic limitation of foreign participation. So, again, different countries have different regimes. The regime in Russia is a pretty restrictive one. So I mean that's the reason. And I think that in our expectations of higher tight oil production in Russia, we do expect that this will be changing. That if Russia wants to get this developed, it will need foreign expertise, foreign technology, perhaps not money, but technology for sure. So we do think that Russia will be changing this regime. Access, first of all, and then taxation, which taxation is is a sort of detrimental factor for any company, be it Russian or foreign, which tries to produce oil in Russia, just because, as you know, if you compare sort of the dynamics of euros, which is the major Russian export blend, so, I mean, the price behaves pretty much like Brent or WTI, so it's a sort of global benchmark price. It's not benchmark, but it's close. Dynamics is close to global benchmarks. But if you look at the price which any company which produces oil in Russia sees, it has been around $20 for the last more than 10 years. So basically, I mean, it's almost flat. I mean, it sort of oscillates, but at a much lower level than nominal price, and the rest goes to the government in terms of taxes. So basically, the government taxes away over 70% of sort of oil price. And why it matters if one thinks about tight oil or Arctic offshore is that production of oil in Russia keeps growing. But it keeps growing only because sort of the current break-even price for oil production in Russia is around $15-16 per barrel. So if we get 20, we make profit. But if we have to tackle tight oil, which is much more expensive, or Arctic offshore, or actually any offshore, this doesn't work. So that's why we think that, I'm pretty sure that the government realized that. So if they want to sort of facilitate production in these new provinces, they will have to change access rule, they will have to change taxation, and they're moving in this direction. I'm an expert for the government tax group, which works on this on these issues for the Ministry of Finance, and I've been sitting on various expert groups which sort of developed this 2020 strategy, where we also suggested sort of major changes in the way Russian oil and gas sector is regulated. We've noted this announcement, but again, as you've read, this is just a proposal from the Ministry of Economic Development, and the sort of a subsequent cabinet meeting just authorized the ministry to clear this proposal with the president's office. And chances of this proposal being cleared, I don't know. I would put less than 50% on that. And even if this goes forth, basically it will mean that at the moment we own slightly less than 20%, so and 10% are in sort of free float. So still, even if another 19% are privatized, the government would still have more than 50%, so it will still be a state-run company. No, we can see that Rosneft eventually will become a private company. What I'm trying to say is that we don't expect this to happen over the sort of nearest future. The major thing for us, it's not that we don't know how to do business with national oil companies. We've been doing business with national oil companies all over the world, including regions that you've mentioned in Azerbaijan. I mean, the state oil and gas company is our major partner, and in other countries we also do that. So, but in Russia, we again, that's only in the beginning. So we've learned how to work with a private partner in TNK-BP. Now we'll have to learn how to work with a state-owned partner in Rosneft, and also we'll have not 50% but less than 20%. So, I mean, these are all new factors that we'll have to learn how to live with, but we're hopeful. Otherwise, our board of directors would have never approved this deal. Which language? I still keep speaking in English. So, shall I translate? The question was about the relations between the European Commission and Russia after the European Commission approved the third energy package. And the specific question was that allegedly the European Union has imposed some limitations on flows via the Nord Stream, the new Russian pipeline to Europe. And no, the European Commission has not limited flow via Nord Stream. What happened is that there are two extensions of this Nord Stream pipeline in Europe. One is called Opal, another NEL, N-E-L. And unlike Nord Stream, which comes from Russia and via international waters in the Baltic Sea, basically both Opal and NEL are pipelines which have been built on the territory of the European Union. And of course, I mean, the third energy package applied to them. So what happened is that Nord Stream owners had to apply for sort of clearing shipments of gas via these two pipelines according to the new procedure. And I mean, that's a pretty tough dialogue. Actually, I sit on the EU-Russia Gas Advisory Council, which again reports to a group where also a member, which is the EU-Russia Energy Dialogue thematic subgroup on strategy and scenarios. And I see the sort of this debate from both sides, because I've been invited by the Russian government to be an expert on the Gas Advisory Council, and I'm a member from the European side in the thematic group to which the Advisory Council reports. So I see how sort of how difficult this debate is. But basically, again, if anybody asks me, I think that there is no chance that the third energy package will be abolished. So Russia will just have to learn how to live in Europe according to these new rules. So I don't see much sense in trying to sort of to continue remaining in the state of denial and saying that everything will go back. And actually, although public rhetoric is pretty straight on the Russian side, I can tell you that Russian companies have already started to learn how to work on a liberal market in Europe. Because again, one of major questions between Russia and European importers is the oil indexation of gas price. So, Russia would like to keep this oil indexation. European gas consumers, again, for the reasons I've been talking about today, they say, you know, we cannot afford to pay this price. We won't be buying your gas if it remains such an expensive one. So anyway, Gazprom, in fact, sells 7 to 8% of its gas in Europe on spot markets. And usually it doesn't publicize that, but it takes only looking at Gazprom export data on their website. Right? Just go there and you see a number for Russia's gas export to the UK. And basically, this export to the UK stands for gas that Gazprom export sells to Gazprom marketing and trading. That's a Gazprom branch in Europe, which sells all the gas, and even more than that, on spot markets. So Gazprom sells gas in Europe both at oil index price and also spot, I mean, liberal price. So again, I think, for me, that's an indication that Gazprom is learning how to work in new conditions, although publicly it keeps saying that they don't like it. And another evidence for me is that Gazprom has already announced that it is interested in extending Nord Stream to the UK. And UK, like the US, is a completely liberal gas market. I mean, it just NBP, national balance and point price, which exists. So, I mean, I can't Can hardly imagine Gazprom coming with its gas to the UK. I mean, not to Gazprom, Martin, but to UK and offering gas at oil index prices. Nobody would be interested. So for me, if they press for this project, it said that they, in their sort of in their mind, they realized that with time they will have to sell gas on spot terms, which is quite sensible, and I think that's exactly the way Russian gas exports will go. And also we might see liberalization of export monopoly. At the moment, as you know, Gazprom is the sole export channel from this country, but if you noticed, the president of Russia has already issued an instruction to think about sort of liberalization of liquefied natural gas exports from Russia. And for me, it's just the first step in the sort of in the direction of more liberal exports. So again, from whatever angle I look at that, I do think that Russia's gas sector will be changing, and I don't see a problem with Russian gas remaining competitive on international markets.
Thank you.
Well, again, leaving aside the chances that this will happen, and actually before joining BP, I had spent 13 years at the World Bank, and just by incidence was a member of a team which initially sort of designed this plan for breaking down Gazprom as a condition of one of World Bank loans to Russia. So it's never materialized. Again, I don't see Gazprom being broken down soon, but if we look at the example of oil sector, where that's exactly the status of affairs. Basically, there is Transneft, a transportation company, which is a public monopoly, and there is more or less diversified production sector, producing sector. So I don't see why the same model would not work in the gas sector. And actually, again, on the production side, we already see the rise of independents. Last year, independent producers contributed, I think, around 27% of Russian gas production, which is a lot, because in the past, Gazprom used to produce 100%. So it is changing, and I think that there will be more pressure. Another pressure will come from actually domestic gas price, and should come from gas consumers in Russia. Actually, at the moment, gas price in Russia is higher than in the United States. And consumers start to feel that, and they start to complain. So again, it's still lower than in Europe, but over the last 10 years, price of gas in Russia grew by a factor of 8. And so consumers have finally started to feel that. And that's again, for Gazprom as a monopoly, that's a necessary step. Because basically, there are problems with profitability of Gazprom. But on the other hand, I see plenty of room for cutting cost in Gazprom. To give you one example, if one looks at staff cost in Gazprom, between the third quarter of last year and the third quarter of 2011, growth in staff cost was 26%. And that's in a company whose production was declining. So which tells me that there is some room for, not to mention that Russian gas pipelines happen to be among the most expensive in the world. And not necessarily Arctic pipelines, just regular pipelines. So again, that's exactly what not only the government, but also the board of directors of Gazprom have started to look at. So I think that's why I'm saying that be it just Gazprom or be it more competitive gas market, there is potential for reducing cost and keeping Russian gas competitive.
Any more questions?
Well, I have a question about the way BP acts not only as a producer but in the paper market. oil side of things. I'm not really too familiar with how oil companies tend to act on that side, but I know airline companies tend to hedge against or for the price of oil. So I just want to know kind of a little bit more about, not too specific, I guess, but what BP tends to do.
We are hedging some of our production. I mean, that's, I mean, there are countries that do that. Mexico, as you perhaps know, I mean, hedge all of its oil production. We don't hedge all of our production, but yeah, I mean, our treasury does operate, our traders does do work on the paper market, but basically we more on the physical side. So we hedge our risks, but we are not sort of a financial investor. So unlike financial investors, we do not invest just in paper. We still care about sort of production levels. So that's our core business. And basically, I mean, one thing which I may mention in this respect, although you should have been tired by now, is that we do not subscribe to the view that by now the fundamentals do not define the oil price. I mean, there is a pretty popular view, and I've attended numerous conferences, including in this country, where people were saying, you know, forget about the fundamentals. Who cares about production level, consumption, demand growth? Basically, it's financial investors who drive oil price. And we think that that's completely wrong. Well, you know, the reason why we have been divesting so much assets, I mean, sort of we had to accumulate $40 billion for our sort of accident in the Gulf. But basically, again, even if we set this aside, if people subscribe to our view of the world, of energy markets, and that we are likely to see price changes on both oil side and gas side, which we are not used to at the moment, it makes sense to become sort of more focused on core business. So that's why we are still a green company and we do produce alternative energy. We have been shedding some solar and wind and recently wind business in the US just because, again, we decided to concentrate on areas where we consider ourselves sort of more experienced than in others. So gas and oil have been and sort of are the main business for the company at the moment. And in production terms, BP is the fourth largest both oil and gas producer in the world. So I mean that's what we do. That's what we would like to continue doing. And so we're sort of trying to focus on this, including in Russia, in this country. Actually, yeah, those who are not going to get a certificate and are tired, I mean, you're free to walk away. So, I mean, I just don't want to use more your time than you're prepared to spare. So, I mean, I'm quite comfortable with only those who have still have questions remaining in the room, so it's up to you. And just please feel to either ask questions or...
Well, if no one has a question, I have two questions.
Sure.
So first of all, I would like to ask you to elaborate a bit on gas price reforms in China. And the second question would be, I would like to ask you your opinion on the fact, I would like to ask you if you think that the Chinese shale production would eventually lead to imports, gas imports in China. According to Skolkova Energy Center and CNPC, they believe that it will not. It may even increase gas demand and thus even gas imports.
Starting with the price reform, it has just started. As you know, they have pilots around Shanghai area, so they're learning how to live with a more liberal, non-regulated gas price. Because for those who don't know, at the moment, companies that import pretty cheap Turkmen gas into China run losses on this imports. Just because, again, with regulated prices, even cheap imports turn to be unprofitable. So we do think that the reform will go on. It will take some time, but when gas price in China becomes sort of more or less liberal, market-based, we think that that will be the moment of truth for all this forecast of sort of unlimited gas growth in China. Because at the moment, I mean, whenever I see sort of forecast that say China will consume as much gas as it can get, I say, yeah, well, okay, yeah. But it's based on the assumption of pretty oil price, gas price. So if price is normal, I think that that will bring economic sense. So we think that, as I said, Russia will be, China will be able to produce 60 billion cubic meters of shale gas. We think that China can produce on its territory up to 200 billion cubic meters. But it will have to import around 180 billion cubic meters by 2030. And from this, we think that around 100 China will import as LNG, and 80 will be volume of pipeline imports. And if one is interested in Russia pipeline export to China, we think that Central Asia, and Turkmenistan in particular, might be able to export like 60 billion cubic meters to China by 2030, and there will be new pipeline from Myanmar. So actually, the room for Russian pipeline gas is not so big. And I mean, in economic terms, Russia will need to sort of to sign a contract for at least 30 BCMA of shipments, sales to China to justify construction of a pipeline. So again, I mean that's exactly why all these sort of negotiations of on Russian gas exports to China have been going for the last 15 years, and each time I see sort of a public announcement that they've agreed everything but price, tells me that they have not moved or progressed much. Just because again, China is not prepared to buy expensive gas. Russia so far has not been prepared to sell gas cheaply. So again, I think that China will have to import gas, but what portion of it will come from Russia will depend on how competitive Russian gas is in that area. And again, I think that there are reasons to believe that it can be competitive, but whether going to China or being exported as LNG, that's sort of an issue which still needs to be tackled. Technically speaking, there is no, there is nothing which would prevent this from happening. And actually, about a year ago, we said that the company would like to get a Russian citizen on its board, not necessarily a person from Rosneft, but again, I haven't heard anything sort of transpiring from this announcement. But basically, yeah, some Western companies do have Russian nationals on their boards. So again, I wouldn't preclude sort of seeing a Russian board member in some time, but whether this person will be from Rosneft or elsewhere, it's too early to say. What we know is that we will get one of our members on Rosneft board this year, and hopefully two members of the board next year. So, I mean, in total. So we would have two people out of nine on Rosneft board. But if you're asking whether there has been an agreement that we'll get these two boards if we give Rosneft a seat on our board, no, there has been no such agreement. So we are just getting what we've agreed to get in Rosneft, but in BP, I mean, on the time will tell whether it happens or not. Technically, as I said, it is possible. There is nothing in BP charter which would prevent a sort of a prominent Russian becoming a member of the board.